into the arms.
Well, Mr. Ambassador, many countries have this problem of differences of opinion between different parts of the country, different elements of the population. In the United States, we resolved this through what is called the Connecticut Compromise, in which there is a federal structure in which powers are divided between the center and the states. But are you telling me that in the 47 Constitution, it was not a federal structure, but a recognition of secession?
Yes.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Was the right of secession actually granted in the 1947 Constitution?
The right of secession was granted, you know, in the 1947 Constitution. Certain states are given the right to secede from the Union in 10 years' time. So in 1958, things, you know, created a lot of difficulty for the government.
But then my impression would be, and I forgive me if I don't know Myanmar better than I should, but it seems to me that you would have a phobia about the possibility of secession, and that your primary objective then becomes holding the country together in unity. Is that a correct interpretation?
You know, Ambassador, you have exactly, you know, put the what is the crux of the problem. It is national unity, the fear of disintegration. Let me tell you, this fear of disintegration has been always with the successive government. In 1958, the Shan state, there was an imminent danger of Shan state seceding from the Union. You know, we call, you know, our, you know, our country Union of Myanmar. We call ourselves, you know, a union of national races. So we have a parliamentary government system at the time. The parliamentary government was not ready to accept that. And the Shans were about to succeed. Of course, under the constitution, you know, they have a right. So, you know, there's the danger of this disintegration of the country. So the prime minister at the time, Unu, passed a resolution in the parliament and handed over the power to the chief of staff, General Ne Win, to form a caretaker government. So what you know, General Ne Win did was to have a caretaker government, and in, you know, a 2 years' time, brought back stability to the country, hold elections, you know, turn over the power back to the political party that, you know, won the election. But again, by 1962, things have you know, gone from bad to worse. And we again face, you know, the danger of disintegration. So there was a military coup in 1962. From 1962 until 1974, the military government, you know, was running the country. In 1974, we have a new constitution. That constitution was a one-party socialist type of, you know, a constitution. And from 1974 until 1988, we have this socialist form of government. One-party system, and the centrally, you know, a, you know, a central command, you know, economy. The people initially welcomed socialism, but over the years, the economic situation has gone really downhill. So in 1988, we have riots all over the country, and there was anarchy for months, There was complete lawlessness. Groups were beheading each other. And finally, the military stepped in again. And in 1988, there was a military government. They initially called themselves the State, you know, Law and Order Restoration Council, because there was complete anarchy there. Later, when things were stabilized, they reconstituted themselves, and the government is called the State Peace and Development Council.
Before we go into this aspect of the erosion, I want you to talk a bit about Aung San, because when I was in school, this was a legendary figure. This was a person who was considered one of the historical figures in the world. Is he a historical figure in Myanmar, or is he somebody who just was a pimple on the face of Myanmar history?
You know, Ambassador, you know, General Aung San is the father of our independence. He is also the father of our, you know, of our army. He was a student leader, and before the Second World War, the people of Myanmar wanted the independence very much. There was a strong movement for independence. So we had by them a diarchy system. We have a prime minister, I should say. It's called the vice chairman of the governor's executive council, who run part of the government. And then the government at the time was also for independence, and the student leaders were strongly for independence. And General Aung San was a student leader. So what happened is General Aung San went around the area looking for countries who will help us regain our independence. And the Prime Minister at the time, U Saw, went to London and asked independence from the British. He told the British, please give us independence after the war, and we will be behind you in the war effort. The British refused. So those days, we came back by ship. So he came back by ship, and when the ship docked in San Francisco, he got down, got in touch with the Japanese military attaché, and gave the same, offered to the Japanese. The British, intelligence got wind of it, and he was arrested in Uganda, and interned in Uganda throughout the country. But General Aung San, initially went to China and meet people from Japan. Japan said he will help us. So General Aung San came back secretly into the country and collected a core group of leaders, altogether 30. They are called the 30 comrades. So they were brought back to Japan, and they were trained in Hainan. And then later they went to Formosa, and Formosa, they went to Thailand. And in Thailand, with the help of the Japanese, we formed our first, military. At the time, we also called ourselves Burma, so it was called the Burma Independence, Burma Independence Army. It was formed in, I think, if I remember correctly, in December 1941. So the role of the military, is such that we have an army even before we have an independent nation. And General Aung San was a father of the independence. He was a father of the army, and he negotiated with Prime Minister Clemens Attlee, and signed in 1947 what was called the Aung San Attlee agreement, by which the British agreed to give us independence. But unfortunately, just before we regained our independence, in July 1947, he and the whole cabinet were assassinated. The British government was not implicated, but elements of the British military intelligence were implicated. What the British government did was they brought back the former Prime Minister U Saw back to Myanmar from Uganda in order to counterbalance General Aung San's influence. And there's a major in the British military intelligence who issued ammunition and uniforms for the assassins. So while General Aung San was having a cabinet meeting, these people went in dressed in uniform, wearing the arms, of a regular military, and killed the entire cabinet.
But if General Aung San is the father of the nation, then that must be a part of the DNA of the daughter also. Now, this daughter, Aung San Suu Kyi, is a very thin, slender person. She's not very weighty. Why are you so scared of her? And why do you have to put her in detention? After all, she's the daughter of the father of the nation. And what's with her or with you for being so frightened of her?
First of all, Ambassador, I personally did not put her into the prison. We always have to go back to history to see how we are and how we get there.